Good morning and welcome to worship. We'll continue with Christ Be Magnified as we praise God this morning with our praise.
Is what's known as a paradox. That's two competing realities, as we are both a sinner and a saint at the same time. It's a constant battle that we cannot win. Of our sinner side, that we are never perfect enough to go to heaven. And it's a constant, we are in a constant rebellion against God. We are opposed to his will, and literally, because of our sinful nature, unable to follow his will. Yet at the same time, because of Christ and his sacrifice and love for us, we are saints before God, covered by his blood. Jesus has won this battle for us, and we have received his victory over death. But until we leave this mortal soil, we continue to live in this paradox. As sinners, we come today to confess our sins and asking for God's mercy, and for the sake of Christ, we receive his grace and forgiveness as a saint. So I ask you to please join me this morning in a prayer and respond with the words that you see on the screen. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, "Come to me, all who are tired, all who are worn out from carrying heavy burdens, and put down the heavy load that you are carrying, and I will give you rest." So, Holy Father God, we confess that we don't always understand our own actions. We clearly know what is right from your word, what you expect of us, but we don't always do it. So, Lord, in your mercy, forgive us, O God. We also clearly know what is wrong, the thoughts and actions that hurt others and offend you, but so often we do these things anyway. Lord, in your mercy, forgive us, O God. And even though we want to do what is right, we fail. Not only did we fail to do what was right, but at times we consciously chose to think and act in ways that we knew were wrong. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Holy God, for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, and his sacrifice for our sins on the cross, and his victory over death on Easter morning, we pray that you set us free from the sin that controls us. In his name we pray. Amen. Well, people of God, know this. Our God is merciful and his love is unfailing. He is slow to anger, and his love sent his Son, Jesus Christ, to die for your sins and my sins on the cross. So as a called and ordained servant of the word and by his authority alone, I announce to you that your sins are forgiven in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated. Before we bring forward our offerings this morning, we just wanted to say a huge thank you for your response to our May Box Ministry. We were collecting items for an organization called Proteus that helps migrant workers that are coming into our area. And thanks to you, we collected over 275 items to assist them, things like wide-brim hats and shirts and gloves and sunscreen and chapstick and items like that as they work out in the fields. But thank you for your generosity. This month, we are going to be collecting items for the food items for the Salvation Army. They give out 100 to 200 boxes of food a month. And now as we head into the summer months, you know, a lot of, you know, all the kids are home. And during the school year, they were getting a couple of meals each day at school. And so it's really putting a strain on some of their family budgets. So we wanted an idea to share with you. And that is, if you're thinking about donating to this, and I hope you are, if you're at the store with your kids, have your kids help you and have them pick out a couple of items that they might enjoy that you could donate to these folks who are in need. And then we'll make sure all those items get over to the Salvation Army at the end of the month. But if you'd like more information about that, you can find that on the box ministry tables. Take one of the bins home, and there's information and a home devotional that you can do to inspire you as you look at ways that you can help out in this regard. But again, thank you for your generosity, and we invite our ushers to come forward to receive our offerings this morning.
Thank you.
With Vacation Bible School coming up this week, starting tomorrow, and all our VBSs in the park, I need to invite everyone who's helping out with Vacation Bible School this week, as well as the three in the mobile home communities. Would you all come up? And I'd like you to come up here on the stage, please. Lead them up there, Lori. Lead them up there, Lori.
Let's lead.
You got to go around the letters.
You up, want up.
Us up? Yeah. That's,
I don't follow directions. Right,
yeah, I hear that. So.
Last year we stood there.
Lori says, last year they stood down here. Well, they didn't. I took them up there too. But that would be just like a typical Lutheran. If we've done it that way, that's the way we always have to do it. But I grew up Methodist, so I like to shake things up. So, all right. Well, good morning. You guys look pretty good up there. We'll just leave you up there for a while. But you have signed up. You volunteered to be willing to help serve in the name of Jesus the little kids that are coming up this coming week and the weeks following to attend our VBS programs here at Peace and at West Park Plaza and Kingswood Estates and Pioneer Estates. So we want to first of all thank you for your service. Let's give them a round of applause. It's going to be a fun time, but at the same time, the responsibility that you have accepted, you know, don't take it lightly, because no matter what your part is, you will be working with Jesus' little disciples this week, children who are eager to learn about God and his love for them. And what you do with them and say to them will be very important as you prepare to share the love of Christ with them this week. Allow us to just have a prayer over you. So let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your power and love as you guide and provide us through Jesus Christ. And we ask your blessing upon these volunteers as they seek to connect every child who comes to VBS to your son, Jesus Christ. And then we ask that you lead these children to take this good news home to their families. Each child in attendance is a precious gift from you. And we thank you for the love and talents of this team that you have assembled to serve these little disciples. We pray this all together in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, go with Jesus' promise to you to be a blessing to our VBS kids. And as they return to their seats, let's give them another warm welcome. Thanks. As they're heading to their seats, I want to invite the kids to come out for the children's message. Be careful of the letters up here. So if you're going to sit in the middle, sit up on the top step.
Oh, wow, we're still coming. This treehouse really takes up a lot. Maybe not through... Okay. That's okay. Be very gentle. It's made out of styrofoam, and it looks really cool. All right, you guys got enough space? All right, how many of you guys like to play games? Yeah, a few of you guys? All right, I need your help to chant my friend Alex up here. So we're on the count of three, we're gonna go Alex, Alex. Okay, ready? Alex, 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 Alex. All right, give him a round of applause, because he doesn't know what he's doing yet. Me and my friend Alex, we're gonna play a game, all right? This is called Dual Tug of War. So what happens is that we have to stand with our feet together. And, I mean, you can stop backing up. You don't have to go that far, bro. All right. What happens is we have to either knock each other off balance to take the first step or we lose the rope, okay? So if I take the first step or lose the rope, then I lose and Alex wins. So who do you think is going to win? Oh, wow, that's brutal. The first service said me, but okay. All right. Ready, three, two, one, go. Do you think we should give him another try?
Yeah.
All right, let's give him another try. Do you think he can learn from his past mistakes? You think he can learn from his past mistakes?
Yeah.
All right, ready? Feet together, Alex, don't cheat. Okay, ready? 3, 2, you're already cheating. All right, 3, 2, 1, go. He learned. He didn't learn. Should we give him one more try? All right, let's give him one more try. Again, let's see if you can learn from your past mistakes, okay? Ready? 3, 2, 1, go. What? Oh, hey, everybody give him a round of applause. All right. So, thank you, Alex. You can go back to your seat. So Alex did pretty good, right? At the end, he learned from his past mistakes. And that's what Pastor Luke's going to be talking about how Jesus helps us learn from our past mistakes to do better and to be able to praise and serve him better. So, because we learn from our past, and in the future or in the present, we can do a lot better to serve Jesus and show him our love back to him. All right? Can you guys fold your hands and pray with me? Father God, thank you so much for all these little ones. I ask that you continue to grow your encourage your faith through the Holy Spirit in their hearts and their minds so they learn how much you love them and how much you, and how much we want to love you back. Help us to learn from our past mistakes, to learn how to serve and worship you more, to respond to your love. In your Son Jesus' name we pray, amen. Thank you, guys. Now, careful of this thing. Maybe not through it. Or I don't know how to control you, so I don't. Okay, maybe you're right. Thank you.
Today's scripture reading is from Romans chapter 7, verses 14 and 15. For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am of the flesh, sold under sin. For I do not understand my own actions. For I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing I hate. This is the word of the Lord.
Stationed at Pearl Harbor. By noon that day, 8 battleships had been sunk or disabled, 2,400 Americans were killed, and a country plunged into a state of shock and dismay. At the same time, Japanese forces began invasions of Malaya and Thailand. The assault aimed to preempt any effort on the part of the United States to act against Japan's hostile expansion efforts in Eurochina. Instead, there awoke a sleeping giant. On December 8, 1941, President Franklin D. Roosevelt called a special joint meeting of the United States Senate and House of Representatives. Included are excerpts from his speech.
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy. The United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan. The United States was at peace with that nation, and at the solicitation of Japan was still in conversation with its government and its emperor, looking toward the maintenance of peace in the Pacific. The attack yesterday on the Hawaiian Islands has caused severe damage to American naval and military forces. I regret to tell you that very many American lives have been lost. In addition, American ships have been reported torpedoed on the high seas between San Francisco and Honolulu. As Commander-in-Chief of the Army and Navy, I have directed that all measures be taken for our defense. But always will our whole nation remember the character of the onslaught against us. No matter how long it may take us to overcome this premeditated invasion, the American people in their righteous might will win through to absolute victory. I ask that the Congress declare that since the unprovoked and dastardly attack by Japan on Sunday, December 7th, 1941, a state of war has existed between the United States and the Japanese Empire.
And it was with those words that our president, Franklin Delano Roosevelt, declared war against the Empire of Japan. I don't know if you could feel it, but there's something about those words and that event that take us back. And we go back and we remember history for a reason, because it has a way of repeating itself again and again and again. We are meant to learn lessons from the past in order to chart new ways into the future, which is why I'm really glad that you're here this morning. I've been excited for the last several months to kick off this sermon series. It's a series that we're simply titling, How Then Shall We Live?, loosely based upon the historical writings of a man by the name of Francis A. Schaeffer. I don't know if you remember Francis Schaeffer. Francis exploded onto the evangelical scene back in the 1960s and 1970s. I don't know why we kind of romanticize that time in American history. The 1960s and 70s tell me it's not true that bell bottoms are coming back in style. Oh my goodness. It was a tough time in American history. Replicates a lot of what we see happening around us today. In the 1960s, the civil rights movement was in full swing, and there was a lot of tension across the United States. Parties disagreed with one another, sometimes violently. There were riots that took place. Some of you were little kids when many of the downtowns across the United States were burned to the ground, much like we saw happen in the George Floyd incident. Americans killed other Americans in the street. And there were people who rose up and asked the question, is this even America anymore? And onto the stage stepped this little historian, Francis A. Schaeffer, and he said, stop, stop. Can we not learn lessons from the past that will take us into the future? Schaeffer became a student of history, and he asked hard questions. Why is it that the Persian Empire that rose up and crushed Babylon itself fell? How is it possible that Greece, ancient Greece, under the leadership of Alexander the Great, lost not one single battle? They rose to immense power, only to fall. What caused their fall? And what about Rome, the greatest empire of them all? It occupied almost every corner of the world. It rose to great power, and then it fell. And how about the United States? Is it possible that we've reached that apex, that turning point, that place where we as a country begin to crumble and fall? We learn lessons from the past in order to chart new ways into the future. This morning, we're going to do that through the words of Paul. I happen to believe that not only is history important, but so is his story. And in the pages of this book that we carry around are people like you and I who have a lot to teach us about what it means to trust Jesus Christ. This morning, I'm going to set one single question in front of you. And I kind of wanted to get into you, and I want you to carry it around maybe into this week. The question is very simply this: is it possible that right now God is calling you in your life to declare war? Let's pray. Lord, as we come around that question this morning, speak to us through the words of Paul, Romans chapter 7. Lord, make those words come to life for us. We pray in Jesus' name. Let's say it together. Amen. I'm going to start with a high-level question. I'll put it on the screen. How is it possible, Christians, how is it possible that this book that we carry around that purports peace is filled with so much war? You ever notice that about the Bible? A few years ago, I was walking through Barnes & Noble. I was just kind of looking at titles of books that I wanted to read. I came across one that irritated me tremendously. It's a book written by a guy named Christopher Hitchens. And the title of the book was very simply this: God is not great. I happen to be a big believer that God is good all the time, all the time. God is what? Good. Amen. How can you write a book that says God is not great? I picked up the book and I began to read it. I read it from cover to cover. And Hitchens, in his book, as an atheist, lays down a simple thought. Here it is. If Christianity is about peace, if Islam purports to be a peaceful religion, why does so much blood lay in the street in the name of God? Was Hitchens right? I don't agree in any way with his presuppositions or his proposal, but I will give him this. You cannot open this book up without discovering that it is filled with stories about war. I made a list. I'll put it on the screen for you. Kind of walked through my Bible, and I thought, yeah, look at all the war, all the battles that are going on, some in families. You ever have family wars? You ever have wars inside of your own family? You know, Cain hated Abel. Joseph's brother sold him. Battles inside a family. Some people of power. If you've ever read 1 and 2 Kings, 1 and 2 Chronicles, there's story after story. This person wants to become king. So what does he do? He kills the other guy so he could become king of Israel. How does that even make sense? There are certainly stories of battles amongst nations. Israel is always at war. Israel is fighting the Hittites. Israel is fighting the Midianites. Israel is fighting the Ammonites. Israel is fighting the termites. Israel is fighting, well, maybe not the termites. I got to check from time to time, make sure you people are awake out there, right? War. Daniel chapter 11 describes a war going on in this room right now. You can't see it, but it's very real. Daniel says, if I could unzip the physical world and separate the curtain and allow you to step behind it for just a second, you would notice that there are angels battling today, right now, over you. Some of those angels belong to Lucifer, the angel of light. They are what we call demons. Some belong to God. They are part of the Sabbath army. And I've always maintained that if we could turn off the lights and turn them back on, and for that split second in between, you were actually allowed to see the spiritual world around you, you would be changed forever. You could not walk out those doors without thinking, my God, there is a battle in the spiritual realm over my soul. But I become convinced that probably the most difficult battle, the most difficult war described in the Bible, isn't happening around us, it's happening within us. You look pretty calm today. When I look out at you, my thought is simply this: I wonder what wars are going on inside of you right now. Paul describes one. It's one that I think we can all relate to in Romans chapter 7. When you read Romans chapter 7, really to understand it, you have to step back and read chapter 6, because he's setting up a scene in which all of us find ourselves. We study the past in order to chart new ways into the future. I'm going to invite you just to read these words with me. This is Paul, Romans chapter 6. He says, "Do you not know that all of us who've been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were buried, therefore, with baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in a newness of life." I've always loved the imagery there. We have a member of this church who very excitedly will say to me from time to time, he'll take me over to the baptism font and he goes, "Pastor Luke, right here, this is where I died. And the first time he said that to me, I stopped for a minute. I said, excuse me? He goes, yeah, right here, I died. Is he right? He is. When we do a baptism in our church, we're taking a beautiful little child or a young person or sometimes an adult, and we come to this water, and we use pretty nice words, but what we really ought to say is, good morning, welcome to the baptism font. Today, you're going to die. Don't drown me. It's the whole point of baptism. That part of us we call the old Adam. Our will, my will. What I wake up with every morning, Luke, I want to be king today, God. I want to do what I want to do, when I want to do it. Get out of my way. But God, I really don't. I don't want to do what I want to do. I want to do what you want me to do. Something inside of me needs to die. There's a war going on inside of you right now. Paul describes that word and that war in beautiful words in Romans chapter 7. I'll put them in front of you. Just look at what he has to say. I know nothing inside of me is good. I want to do good, but I don't have the ability to do it. Instead, I do the things I desire not to do. I don't do the things I desire to do. How many of you have found yourself fighting that war before? Yeah. We're there. I want to learn a couple of things about war with you today. So if you allow me, we're going to step back to the date, December 7th, 1941. Two things we can learn. The first one is that in war, sometimes strategy matters. When the Japanese Empire determined to attack the United States of America, why December 7th? Did they just kind of get a calendar out and randomly say, that looks like a great day to attack America? No. They strategically studied our Pacific Fleet. And so you know what? Most of the time, it would be impossible to overcome the Pacific Fleet because they're here, and they're here, and they're here, and they're here. It would take all kinds of airplanes, trying to stay hidden. We couldn't do it. Aha. But the foolish Americans in December park all of their aircraft carriers in one place, Pearl Harbor, and they become vulnerable to attack. Do you know that you have an enemy that does the same thing? He's studying you right now. He can't read your thoughts, but oh, he watches you. He knows when you let your guard down. He knows when you begin to engage in behavior that is addictive and that pulls you in. He understands when you have hatred in your heart for another person. He watches you daily, and he determines your vulnerabilities so that he can attack you, your children, your students in high school, your kids who've gone off to college, your grandkids are under attack. The second thing I want you to learn from December 7th, 1941 is when he attacks, he often attacks in multiple points all at the same time. We remember Pearl Harbor, but do you remember that there were six other sites that were attacked on December 7th, 1941? Six other sites. We don't even remember those. What was the enemy trying to do? Overwhelm. I hear it this way. People walk into my office, they go, Pastor Luke, it's too much. It's too much. I feel like my life is falling apart. This happened, and then this happened, and this happened, and then this happened, and I just can't take it. I thought God wouldn't give me more than I can handle, and he's given me way more than I can handle. Where is he anyway? And the enemy wants to so overwhelm you that you just give up. That you don't trust God's promises. But I have some good news for you today. You also have a God who fights for you. I want you to remember these two things about God. We follow a God who has declared war against the one who has declared war against you. Let that one soak in for a minute. He's fighting for you. We follow a God who has declared war with that old person inside of us. That means each day to put that part of me to death that would rise up against him. And I pray God win that war on a daily basis. So I'm going to leave you today with just two questions. The first, very serious. I want to come back to it. Is there a place in your life right now where God would call you to declare war? How would you fill in this blank? Today, right now, I declare war with what? Over the last couple of weeks, I have very anonymously been able to talk to a number of people about what they would put in that blank. The first person that I talked to said to me, my own mind. I've gotten so negative about life. I don't think people even want to be around me. I said, declare war. One young man said to me, I declare war against my own eyes. Pornography. He says, I don't want to look at it. But I do. And then I get away from it, and I think I've beaten it, and I get dragged back in. I feel shame. I said, today, declare war. One person, and this was kind of moving for me, is a dad. He says, Pastor Luke, I'm going to be honest. He says, if I'm really honest with myself, we haven't been in church in a long, long time. Because our family is so busy. We don't seem to even have time for God. So maybe today is the day that you declare war. Where is it in your life that you need to just bow down on your knees and say, God, I hear you. There's an enemy at work in me. And on this day, I declare war. Where will you find the strength for that? Not in yourself. No, you'll find that strength in God and God alone. St. Paul says it most beautifully. Romans chapter 7, who is it that can set me free from this body of death, this war that I'm in? Thanks be to God for Jesus Christ. I'll leave you with a word from 2 Chronicles that I've always loved. King Jehoshaphat was facing the Midianite army. He didn't know how to overtake them, and he cries out to God, and here's what God said to him, and he's going to say it to you today. Don't be afraid. Whatever you put in that blank, today I declare war with, boom. Don't be afraid. Don't be discouraged. Because the battle does not belong to you. The battle belongs to the Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let us pray this morning. Holy God, Father in heaven, we are in a battle. We're in a battle within us and a battle raging around us all the time. But we take refuge in your protection and face evil behind the shield of your word. Protect us from the evil one, for we know by faith the eternal victory is always yours. Holy God, we pray for all who are challenged in mind, body, and spirit, especially Andy Coles, who underwent a heart ablation this week, for Dave Gee as he continues to heal from an infection, for Alden Flackel as he is treated for pancreatitis, and for Ed Bills, who's recovering from a recent hospital stay. Lord, we celebrate the birth of a new grandson, Carson, born to Ross and Cassandra Lyon. May Carson grow in faith and joy through the love of his parents, Kara and Christian. And Lord, as we return to the search for a third pastor here at Peace, we lift up all churches in need of a shepherd and pray for your spirit to lead more men and their families into ministry, to serve in your churches here in Nebraska and throughout the world. And we ask again your blessing upon our Vacation Bible School this week and the families who will be reached through the hearts of faith in their children. We ask that you grant the leaders and volunteers your strength and joy each day as they share the gospel through their words and actions. And we thank you for the energy and compassion of the Williamson family who join us every year to lead music for the week. In all ways, O God, keep us safe in the fortress of your love as the battle rages around us. We walk in your presence and pray as your Son taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. I thank you for joining us for worship this morning and making this a part of your family's rhythm each and every week. I want to remind you one last time that this afternoon at 4 p.m. we have a VBS preview, so if you want to come and see everything that's going to be laid out so you know what to expect on Monday morning, that would be great. But receive our Lord's blessing then as you head out into your week. May the Lord bless and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Amen.
Father, let your kingdom come. Father, let your will be done. On earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. Father, let your kingdom come. Father, let your will be done. On earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us as we forgive the ones who sinned against us. Forgive them and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Let your kingdom come. Father, let your kingdom come. Father, let your will be done. On earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. Father, let your kingdom come. Father, let your will be done. On earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us as we forgive the ones who sin against us. Forgive them and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Let your kingdom come. It's yours, it's yours, all yours, all yours. The kingdom, the power, the glory.
God bless.